Now, we'll talk about a few issues related to attrition that frequently arise in studies. Often, missing data are an issue when conducting research. When a study is missing outcome data, researchers may impute data by replacing the unobserved data in some way. For example, study authors may use a technique called multiple imputation to predict missing values, or they may replace missing values with the group mean. The WWC specifies several acceptable ways to impute data, which we will cover in later modules. Research indicates that, like attrition, imputation may introduce bias into study findings. Remember that RCTs have the potential to receive the WWC's highest rating, meets group design standards without reservations, because we can be confident that the groups created by random assignment were similar at the time of random assignment, and the differences in outcomes between the groups are due to the intervention. Imputed data can lower our confidence that the difference in outcomes between the intervention group and comparison group are due only to the intervention and not due to how the study imputed the data. To address these concerns, when an RCT reports on analyses based on imputed outcome data, it must treat the imputed data as attrition. Another issue to consider is that researchers sometimes exclude units from their analysis. If doing this creates differences between the intervention and comparison groups, it could introduce bias. The WWC uses two questions to determine whether an exclusion has the potential to introduce bias. Depending on the answer to these two questions, the WWC treats the exclusions one of three ways. The first question asks whether the study excluded sample members using a measure that the intervention may have affected. If so, this could compromise the integrity of the random assignment. The second question asks whether the study applied the exclusion criteria consistently across groups. The WWC is concerned about exclusions that could favor one group over the other and may count the exclusions as attrition. Working through some examples will help to illustrate how these two questions are used to guide reviews. A study is testing the effect of a math intervention on fourth grade students. The researchers mistakenly included some third and fifth grade students during random assignment. They exclude those students from the analysis. First, we ask whether the study excluded those students based on something that the intervention might have affected. In this case, the study excluded students based on their grade level. The students were already in those grade levels before the intervention, so the exclusions are unrelated to the intervention. So the answer to question one is no. Second, we ask whether the study applied the exclusion consistently to both groups. The researchers excluded third and fifth grade students from both the intervention and comparison groups. So the answer to this question is yes. These answers suggest the exclusions have little potential to introduce bias, so the exclusions do not count as attrition. To assess attrition for a study in this category, the WWC only calculates attrition within the subsample, that is, the students who are in the fourth grade. The denominator should be the number after exclusions, not the full sample. In this case, the denominator would be the number of students randomized after excluding the third and fifth graders. Exclusions often occur in larger random assignment studies that may not have the time or resources to follow every student in their sample. Such studies may choose to collect follow-up data from a random subsample of the initially randomized sample. So a study might randomly assign 2,000 students and then select a random subsample of 500 students to follow. Random subsampling from the full initial sample of 2,000 students is perfectly acceptable from the WWC's point of view. The exclusion criteria was random, so the intervention couldn't affect it, and the study applied it consistently across groups. What if the study did not apply the exclusion consistently? So the answer to the question two is no. For example, suppose a study excluded younger students from the intervention group, but not from the comparison group. These exclusions are based on age, so the answer to question one is still no, because the exclusions were not based on something that the intervention could affect. But the researchers did not apply the criterion consistently across groups because they left younger students in the comparison group. In this situation, the WWC would count the excluded younger students as attrition. Now, What if the answer to question one is yes? This leads to the third WWC approach to sample exclusions. If the exclusion is based on characteristics that the intervention could have affected, then the WWC considers the random assignment process to be compromised. This means the study needs to demonstrate equivalence, and attrition is irrelevant. For example, sometimes researchers exclude students in the intervention group who didn't attend all the sessions of the intervention. The intervention could affect attendance, and the WWC is concerned that these situations can lead to systematic differences between groups, which could introduce bias. Therefore, these studies must demonstrate equivalence. One last example. In a study, researchers will conduct follow-up surveys in two waves. They randomly selected students who completed wave one to participate in the follow-up survey for wave two. In this case, the researchers subsampled based on the students who completed an earlier phase, not based on the full randomized sample. Did they base the decision on something that the intervention could have affected? No. They based it on random subsampling. Did they apply the exclusion consistently across groups? This one is a bit tricky. The answer is no, because they applied the exclusion to the subset of each group that responded to the first wave, not to the full randomized sample. This means that the exclusions between wave 1 and wave 2 represent attrition. The study must assess attrition separately at both time points relative to the full randomized sample. The attrition calculation for wave 2 should count all students who left the study between randomization and wave 2 as attrition. Non-participation is another issue to consider when assessing attrition. We discuss non-participation in the Group Designs module, which is Module 1. It occurs when an individual assigned to an intervention condition doesn't participate in it. For example, students might leave an intervention classroom or refuse to participate in the intervention. Sometimes studies still observe outcomes for these students. If the individuals assigned to the intervention don't participate, it may decrease the study's likelihood of finding an impact of the intervention. However, non-participation does not introduce bias as long as the researchers still collect outcome data from the non-participants and analyze them according to their assigned conditions. The WWC counts non-participation as attrition if the study doesn't collect outcome data from non-participants. However, if the study collects outcome data from non-participants and includes the students in the analysis according to their originally assigned conditions, then non-participation does not count as attrition. As mentioned in the Group Designs module, which is Module 1, studies must analyze individuals according to the condition to which they initially assigned them. Sometimes researchers will treat an intervention group student who did not receive the intervention as if he or she belonged to the comparison group. If a study changes the condition of any student, then it compromises the integrity of the random assignment. In that case, then attrition is irrelevant because the study must demonstrate equivalence regardless of the attrition rates. Studies don't always report everything the WWC needs to complete a review. In these cases, the WWC will ask authors to fill in any gaps, but authors don't always respond or have the information the WWC needs. For example, a study might report the number of students who left the study, but not what condition they were assigned to. If so, the WWC can calculate the overall attrition rate, but not differential attrition. If the authors can't provide the missing information, the study still has a chance to demonstrate low attrition. To do this, reviewers can assume the worst case and find the highest differential attrition rate possible. Suppose there are only two conditions. The reviewer could first assume all the attrition came from the intervention condition and calculate the differential attrition rate under that extreme scenario. Then the reviewer could calculate differential attrition assuming all the attrition came from the comparison condition. The reviewer would then choose the higher of the two differential attrition rates to use in determining whether attrition is high or low for the study. If the study has low attrition even when using the highest possible differential attrition rate, then the WWC can be certain that the risk of bias from attrition is low.